Hi. Thanks. Thanks for staying up later. I am Paul Provenza, and I am filling in this evening for Bob Costas. Now, tonight here on Later, we also have a little experiment. We have an audience with us this evening, which we don't often do. Welcome. Just by taking the of your being here, how many of you enjoy a good mime show every now and then? And now, by contrast, how many of you would enjoy every now and again to see a mime getting beaten about the head and neck? There you go. I think it's safe. And my guest this evening on Later is no exception. He hates mimes too. Only difference is he has sometimes been called one. Wrongly so. He is much more than a mime. He is more than even a clown. He is a physical comedian of inestimable talent and an intellect to match. And I'm very pleased to have with us tonight Mr. Bill Irwin. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Yourself, how would you categorize yourself as a performer?
Well, it depends on who's asking. When I applied for a loan, when my wife and my son and I was a producer-writer. But I think of myself as a clown and an actor. And those are the words I like best.
Mm-hmm. And the show that you are presently doing on Broadway, Full Moon, in which you co-star and co-created with David Schreiner.
Right. David Schreiner.
Schreiner.
Yeah, we call him Schreiner just to make him mad. And
he keeps showing up with that fez. You can't help it. it's an extraordinary show, and I don't know how to describe it to...
Neither do we, and I'm glad to hear you say that. We're asked what we do on Broadway 8 times a week, and it's 2 clowns and a 5-piece band. That's the minimal description.
Physical rigors of the show are remarkable. I mean, I don't know how you guys can walk out of the theater every night. I mean, you truly are athletes to the nth degree.
Well, thank you.
It is remarkable. How do you prepare for the show? I mean, there's clearly the skills of a dancer, the skills of a mime, a clown. You do pratfalls. It's unbelievable. I mean, it's got to take a toll.
It takes a toll, and yet it's the old story with clowns. They said, does it hurt when you do a pratfall? It doesn't hurt if they laugh. You know, if nobody laughs, you feel each bone contacting the floor. There's like a cushion when you, you know, the oldest bit in the butt. How much room do we have here, Paul?
I couldn't tell you. I have no idea.
Carpet. If you're walking along, one of the things we laugh at the most is what we're afraid of, and what we're afraid of almost more than hurting ourselves physically is losing dignity. You know, so when you ask about warm up, you sort of you get there, you warm up a little bit, but you gotta look for the get that feeling going. The interesting thing about tripping is that if you just do the trip, there's not much there, as the people from St. Louis and elsewhere will tell you. There's not much of a laugh there. What's funny about tripping, and part of the warm-up each night, is you trip and you have to check out what it was that you contacted with.
It's the human response.
It's the human response, yeah. You got to deny what you did. So that, for instance, you know, if you trip the same place 3 times in a row, there's 1, 2, and then... step over it for 3. It's good.
You see, now that's the kind of thing. That's the kind of thing. I'm excited by your analysis. That's something so simple. A guy tripping. I mean, the oldest gag in the book.
Oldest gag in the book.
And yet, you break it down into this elaborate scenario. And look at what's going on. And look at how many elements are involved here. What's your background? I mean, how much of this is instinct for you, and how much of it is trained and skilled?
Good question. You never. If you ever know the answer, you may be in big trouble there, because you've got to think of construction within physical comedy, but you've got to throw it away too, and it must be not unlike stand-up, your craft, which I can only marvel at from a distance. But
except we have the tool of language to help us, and we can express ideas that for, in order for us to express ideas with nuance, we have a variety of language to do that, and you've got your body.
Which is full of language. We rarely give ourselves credit for how much language we're taking in. You know, you and I are sitting here, because we're on TV, we tend to look each other in the eye, like man to man. But in fact, we rarely look each other in the eye in real life. That's like too dangerous. When you work in the circus, they say, never look a chimpanzee in the eye because he'll take it as a threat.
Which is the same for stand-up comedians, by the way.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, okay. A lot of chimp behavior is similar in stand-up comedians.
It's very similar.
Comedians.
I'm going to...
Yeah. In fact, I feel like preening you right now.
I preened before I came in. The thing is, we tend to look each other about chin to sternum level a lot of the time, because otherwise it's just too much to look into the eyes. So a lot of the language that we're sending out to each other comes between here and here. We read each other a lot from nose to sternum, so that people are really often telling each other a lot of things down in here.
Well, I'm not sure what you just said there, but ooh, didn't look very happy, whatever that was.
A world of language was going on. There's a lot we're telling each other when, and the sort of postural curves of the body, we're reading madly, because we're always looking to see whether we're threatening each other, whether we're sort of interesting each other, and much more of it is physical than we figure. I happen to bring, spilled water. I happen to bring...
very deft, by the way.
It was pretty deft. It was going over the... But this is a hat from the show, and the amazing thing about just a piece of felt like this is that it's full of language. If you wear it this way, you know, it tells a certain story. But the same piece of felt, you know, with just a little different arrangement, starts telling a whole different story than when you add spectacles, which I do instead of makeup. I used to put a lot of white makeup on. It took half an hour to get on and 45 minutes to get off, and I just put these spectacles on. You start to posit a character. There's a guy there, and the way he thinks of himself, the way he arranges himself. I often, in warming up before the show, just sort of take some muscles and you put them somewhere, and you have a guy. There's a character that starts to happen. You take the exact opposite. And it's just a set of muscles going somewhere, but it starts to set ideas off, starts to tell the audience things.
Yeah, I mean, it's remarkable. Did you discover this gift first and then develop it, or did you set out to develop this and end up with this gift?
It's a very, very good question. Not unlike you, I bet. I watched endless black and white TV back in the 50s. You may be younger than I, Paul.
Not so much
not
that
so
it
much.
Would please me.
But the guys and women who began early TV, the performers, a lot of them had done years of stage time. So that one of my favorite jokes with David Shiner is we sometimes in warming up, we're just trying to get ourselves going. We imagine Jackie Gleason walking into a TV casting office now, you know, and people would say, oh, he's very talented, but he's too much energy. You know, we like somebody sits on chairs. This is sort of the TV mode now. Mm-hmm. That early TV was full of wild energy,
and I guess they in fact physicalized a lot of that.
Physicalized energy, a lot of stuff. Yeah. So an entrance by Ed Norton and the Honeymooners was a very physical thing, and they kept the camera head to toe. And with all due respect to the gents here, a lot of people don't seem to like to do that anymore. You know, they tilt up to the face only because this is sort of 1980s and 90s mode of communication on TV. Whereas in the early days, it was much more a head to toe.
Interesting.
Medium.
So by seeing that and by studying that, did you realize that you had that same gift?
Well, it just
physicalized?
Interested me a lot. Uh-huh. The notion of what's told by the whole body. If you take this same just to carry forward motif, if you take this same set of guys or the people that come out of arranging the body a certain way, and you give them something to do, like those same trips. This guy, and the body will tell you how to handle it. You know, this guy in tripping is going to take the trip. You take this guy and arrange the muscles out here. Not only the fact that his weight is all forward, but this is the way his head is arranged. He's probably going to trip. You know, there's...
So much like an actor who's working verbally as well as physically, once the character is established, the behavior becomes instinctual.
Right, right, right. Sometimes you take on an accent, all kinds of ideas come. It's the same thing with the body. You sort of give the body an accent. Mm. It's one of my favorite parts in the show because David does so much of the work and he's so funny at it. He sort of takes someone on a date. There's a,
right.
someone he drafts from the audience. He takes her...
What a nice way of putting it.
You've
Some
seen
people
the show,
call it being
you.
Shanghaied.
Well, they're usually very happy they've been up there. he takes somebody on a date, takes her on a drive and everything. They ended up at the restaurant where I get to make an appearance as the sort of oily waiter. And it's amazing how the musculature will tell you how this sort of oily French waiter and how he immediately sees the woman who's on the date. And now it becomes a competition between David and I for the woman. It's a great joy to play in front of an audience. We're having, right now in the summer months, a lot of foreigners who speak no English, and you can feel the relief.
Interesting.
You know, yeah.
Interesting.
I don't have to worry English now. I go, and families come.
Angels in America, too much for me.
Yeah. Very long.
That's great. I'm interested in, because I work comedically, verbally, exclusively, I'm interested in the nuances that you can understand from an audience working just physically, the different kinds of laughter. You once described in an interview that a comedic performer has different categories of laughter in their heads, much the same way an Eskimo has an infinite number of words for snow.
I think so.
Just think of as snow, but they have very specific understandings of all the nuances of snow. And I thought that was a really clever analogy, and I was surprised that somebody who worked physically could also feel those. Because when you're working verbally, you know, you're dealing with ideologies and concepts that are, you know, and I thought it was interesting.
But you get that feeling too.
Oh, absolutely. But I would think that working purely physically, where you can communicate to audiences of different languages and what have you, that you would understand those nuances, that you would get those kinds of nuances as well. I think that's absolutely fascinating.
You do, and of course, as you know, when laughter is your business, you're reading them constantly. Are these folks getting the ideas that I have in mind? Am I in tune with them? Are they having a good time? What's happening? One of the things that interests me always is gender laughter, you know, what the men in the audience laugh at, mm-hmm. what the women in the mm-hmm. audience laugh at. I used to do a routine a long time ago that involved, it was a clown routine, so I had large shoes on, drop a trunk on the shoe, get the trunk off, and now the foot is throbbing so that with the length of the trunk here, it's, oh, geez. So the foot almost becomes like another person, or it's, when you try to comfort the foot, it goes, oh. All right, come here. Come on. Hey, come here. Very interesting to me, I'm sort of listening as we're doing this, that especially with the big shoes and the thing is going like this and you can't reach it, lots of times men laugh at that. It's almost like I've been there, I can't get the kid to sit there. I'm trying to comfort the kid. And then at a certain point, you sort of look away as if you're in and grab it, ow, okay. And that's where the women laugh always.
Interesting.
Nurturing.
I don't know exactly what that means.
I don't
it really
know that it means
remarkable.
Anything, but I listen to it night after night, and it is fascinating.
We're back with Bill Irwin. Now, obviously, when people see you, people in the television industry, the film industry see you, they recognize your talent, but I would imagine that they have this problem defining it, as we do ourselves, sitting here, this problem, they must look at you and go, this is an amazing talent. What do we do with this? How do we use this? And yet, you've had quite a lot of film and television work.
Well, I've done some film stuff and had great fun doing it. To date, I've never gotten the same feeling of satisfaction working in front of a camera, of any type, as I do with a live audience present. There's something I like about the contract that you have with the audience. Every night we do Full Moon. There are 1,200 people there who decided to come to that thing. Mm-hmm. Now, we'll run 6 months with Full Moon, and at the end of 6 months, we won't have played to as many people as will sort of glance at this tonight and listen to us talking. Anytime you walk in front of a TV camera, you are seen by more people than we'll play to in 6 months on Broadway. But the contract with those folks, they invested their time and their money to come to that thing and sit in that red plush chair and look up at you and decide that you're the best bet for a fulfilling evening. I like that contract very much, and it must be similar to what film people feel and really great television stars feel with the audience via the camera, and I've yet to quite feel that. I played a baseball player in John Sayles' movie. It was a serious role, not a...
It was Eight Men Out.
Eight Men Out, yeah. Not a comic role. Yeah. Had great fun doing that, partly because it was so physical and got to sort of do a lot of the language of the body, a very different language than we use in Full Moon, but...
Now, I saw you in another feature, Scenes from a Mall,
yes,
with Woody Allen and Bette Midler, which was not a very well-received movie.
No.
But your work in it was interesting, and I thought back to some of the other things that I had seen you in, My Blue Heaven, and I realized that what happens with you in these kinds of roles is you find moments
uh-huh.
that stand out, and it seems to me that the directors and the people involved in the production seize those moments, and they sort of shine. They're almost set pieces. They almost stand apart at the same time as being part of the story. Mm. For instance, in My Blue Heaven, you have this sort of dance sequence that kind of comes out of nowhere, but it's so elegant and it's so charming, and it kind of holds, it's the glue that kind of holds the transition together.
It does seem to sort of do that in the movie, and poor Nora Ephron, who wrote that movie, didn't see it anywhere until she saw it in the movie, because it was the thing that Herb Ross said, I think we'll have Agent Kirby, this FBI, sort of dopey FBI guy that I was playing. I think we'll have him merengue here.
Now, if the music were to start suddenly here, would that impulse draw you out of that chair?
Sound is coming in the ear. It's like the first place you hear it, but... You check and see who is watching, you know, how inadvertently you got going, but... Maybe it's too much. I am sorry. Oh. But if you think about self-consciousness as an idea, you know, like maybe you allow the foot to go and nothing else. How many times you keep going? Thank you.
It must have been exciting working with Woody Allen and Bette Midler, two great comic performers. Woody Allen, particularly in contrast to yourself, his character, his general character, is very much like the characters that you portray, sort of little guy against
yeah.
you know, forces greater than he.
Yeah.
Yet he's so completely verbal.
Right.
And you were completely physical. What was that like working with him, and was there any connection there? Did you relate to him in any way? And, of course, the role you had was one of the forces acting on him. Basically.
Yes, I was a sort of harrying force in his life as he was trying to pursue put his marriage back together in this shopping mall.
Olive Manka, remember that olive tree we sat under?
Isn't
that step? You know, he's terrific. I think this is our best trip
it
so
was.
Far.
It was. Sexually, that was our best
Sex
trip. That's what I think of it.
On
is it? I think excuse us, please. I hate mimes.
Oh,
so
honey, don't be mean.
No, what is this guy eavesdropping? What if this is not cute?
Give him a buck.
Give him a buck for what?
There's a time and a place for cruelty. Give him a dollar.
Erotic, intimate conversation? Here, but please go away. These guys are worse than Harry Krishna's.
He was a very nurturing co-player, and his life is very complicated right now, but I will never forget the moment that after I slugged him and fell to the ground, and there's a sort of tight shot where I'm on the ground pretending I've been hit by him. Paul Mazursky, the director, kept saying, Bill, we got to get you up into that shot. But being a stage player, I was laying it out there. I thought it was great how I was sucked into the floor. The gravity was getting me. But can't see Irwin. We can't see the mime. We'll get him up. I felt this set of fingers underneath it. It was Woody Allen. I said, why don't your parents to see this? Mom and Dad see the movie. So, every take, there was this little hand just arching my back slightly. He's a solo player, but he's a co-player, too. And that's one of the little bits I remember from the movie.
What happened here?
I get to hit a mine before I die.
I'm a licensed psychotherapist. This man is an outpatient.
I'm not a violent person.
I
hit him in the makeup for a minute.
Here, take
$100.
It'll
make you feel much better. I never hit anybody
before. Yes, he's fine.
I'm an outpatient.
Let's
move on. Interesting in scenes from a mall, you played a mime.
I did.
A street mime, basically, performing in a mall.
With trepidation, because I knew I'd be introduced as one thereafter. But it was such a good part, I couldn't say no. And he gets slugged, as mimes deserve to be.
There's a little satisfaction for some of the audience.
And for one mime in particular.
Why do you think it is that mimes are so maligned?
Well, a lot of them, unfortunately, just aren't very good. You know, there's a great desire to perform in almost all of us. And unfortunately, there seems to be the feeling that if I paint my face in a certain way and put the right lines on and the right tear over here, it doesn't matter how much I've practiced or how good I am.
The stories you care about, because 12 News cares about you.
I want to thank Mr. Bill Irwin for being here tonight. Bill, thank you. The show is
Full
Moon at the Richard Rogers Theater. Closes September 5th because of prior commitments. Do not miss it. I'm Paul Provenza. Bob will be back next week. Thanks for staying up later. Good night.